बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। डॉक्टर मोहम्मद लतीफ वेलकम यू इन अक्सर सेट ट्रस्ट हॉस्पिटल। आई एम डिस्कसिंग विद यू टुडे द ब्लीडिंग डिसऑर्डर्स। द लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव्स आर एट द एंड ऑफ द लेक्चर यू विल नो द कॉमन कॉजेज ऑफ ब्लीडिंग डिसऑर्डर्स, देयर वेरियस क्लिनिकल मैनिफेस्टेशंस ऑफ दीज डिसऑर्डर्स and the treatment options or treatment drugs of the relevant disorders depending upon the deficient factor. Von Willebrand disease, first of all, this is a common, very common disease inherited genetically, and clinically it presents as a heterogeneous disorder ranging from hemorrhagic disorder caused by deficiency, dysfunction of the protein Von Willebrand factor, which is in fact an antigen protein. There is an interaction between the platelets and the vessel wall which impairs the hemostasis. Von Willebrand factor is a multimeric glycoprotein. It circulates in the plasma and when stimulated it is released from the storage granules in the platelets and endothelial cells of the capillaries. There are two roles of the Von Willebrand factor. One is that it mediates the adhesion of the platelets to the injured vessel wall. So remember the term adhesion. Second, it binds and stabilizes the factor A, which is also a protein, but it is a pro-coagulant protein. There are different categories of this Von Willebrand factor. Number one is type 1, in which there is partial quantitative. Remember first the quantitative, but it is partial deficiency. Second one is a qualitative defect of the Von Willebrand factor, which means that its function is impaired or it is partly dysfunctional. Therefore it is known as qualitative defect. And the third variety is in which there is total absence of the Von Willebrand factor. This Von Willebrand type 2 is divided into four types or varieties or variants, which are 2A, 2B, 2N and 2M. Which is based on their dysfunctional characteristics. These categories have distinct molecular mechanisms and therefore there will be corresponding clinical features depending upon the molecular change. The therapeutic and the therapeutic recommendations will vary upon the type of the variant, like 2A, 2B, 2N and 2M. Clinical features of the Von Willebrand disease are very simple. Patient may present to you with epistaxis, hematomas, prolonged bleeding from the trivial injuries or wounds, and sometimes the patient presents to you with the oral cavity bleeding, and sometimes the ladies present with the menorrhagia. There may be easy bruising, but it is a non-specific feature of the Von Willebrand disease. Sometimes there is prolonged bleeding after minor trauma to the skin or mucous membranes, but the mucous membrane and the skin may also bleed without any trivial trauma. Severe hemorrhage may be followed by surgical interventions or major surgical procedures. Sometimes the delayed bleeding is expected, which means that after the surgery has been undertaken many weeks back and the patient presents to you with the bleeding. Therefore it is known as delayed bleeding. And sometimes the patient presents to you with the heavy bleeding following tooth extraction, oral surgical procedures like adenoidectomy, tonsillectomy and oral dental procedures. The bleeding may worsen after the administration of the aspirin because aspirin has a role in the aggregation of the platelets, thereby impairing the function of the platelets. The bleeding may ameliorate or become better or improve or stop after the administration of the oral contraceptives, because oral contraceptives are pro-coagulants. the at the time of the birth, the baby may present with the umbilical stump bleeding, and the patient may, the child may present sometime with the cephalohematomas, and usually not at the time of the birth, but the when the child say is about 1 to 2 years or 3 years or 5 years. Minor injury, the patient, the child may develop cephalohematoma, which does not improve with the conventional treatment. So you have to be suspicious of whether this cephalohematoma is might not be because of the bleeding disorder, von Willebrand disease. So sometime also the patient present with the cheek hematomas and spontaneous conjunctival bleeding, post circumcisional bleeding and post vena puncture bleeding. Very common feature in our hospitals or wherever there is some IV drug administration or IV fluid or anything which is administered IV, the vena puncture sites do not stop. At the site of the vena puncture site, the bleeding does not stop. So remember, if after puncturing the vein, the bleeding does not stop, do think of the von Willebrand disease. Signs may also be jaundice or spider angiomata, splenomegaly is also may be a finding, but it is a rare one in von Willebrand disease. Arthropathy is also a very not less frequent finding, and similarly laxity of the joints and the skin may also be there, and especially the laxity over the joint skin. And the patients may have telangiectasia over the whole of the body, and sometimes especially over the face and nose and upper part of the chest of the body. And the same way, the spider angiomata may be found on the limbs and torso and face, etc. These are two vascular, I mean the arterial and venous abnormalities of the vessel, which may be like lace-like or long thread-like vessels, may be the arterioles as well as the venules. Investigations, first of all you have to check the von Willebrand factor activity, which ranges from 50 to 200 international per deciliter. The other name is risdiplam cofactor activity. Actually it is a check of the activity of the von Willebrand factor. Then von Willebrand factor assay by giving the glycoprotein 1b mutants, which binds the von Willebrand factor, and the amount is measured. This is known as von Willebrand factor assay. Then von Willebrand antigen assay. Antigen assay, actually the factor is an antigen. Its assay, I mean its measurement, which will tell you the its levels, and you can find the deficiency. Now sometimes the discrepancy between the antigenic value and the risdiplam cofactor activity, which means the functional capability of the von Willebrand factor, will tell that the patient is suffering from the qualitative defect. The other common tests, bleeding time, prothrombin time, APTT and BT and APTT abnormal. Remember, BT and APTT are abnormal in the von Willebrand disease, but PT is normal. Then typing of the von Willebrand disease, type 1 and 2. In type 2, the platelet-dependent functions of the VWF are reserved, but factor 8 is low. Remember, categorically, that in type 2 VWD, the factor 8 is low. The functions of the platelet-dependent functions of the VWD are reserved or preserved. Distribution of all Willebrand disease. Type 1 is 25%, type 2 is 66%, and type 3 is 8% only. And unknown type is only 1%. Investigations, non-belligerent type 2, specific absence of the, there will be specific absence of the large multimers. In non-belligerent type 3, non-belligerent protein virtually undetectable in the circulation. So it is a quantitative defect because it is virtually absent. The testing therapeutic option, I mean you give the test dose of the DDABP and there will be thrombotic complication because the job or function of the arginine vasopressin is the production of the or genesis of the thrombin formation or coagulation. It is pro-coagulant in the other way. It is a treatment of the von Willebrand disease. So when you offer the testing dose for exclusion of the von Willebrand type 2, the patient may develop thrombosis or thrombotic complication. Differential diagnosis, it may range from factor A deficiency or hemophilia, factor hemophilia B, factor 9 deficiency, then factor 10 deficiency, factor 11 deficiency, Bernard-Soulier syndrome, which is an acquired platelet functional defect. And similarly, when the patient is receiving any anti-platelet drugs, which cause the impairment of the hemostasis or coagulation, and the patient may present with the bleeding to you. Patient taking aspirin and clopidogrel may present to you with the bleeding. Similarly, the warfarin-like drugs, the patient may present to you with the drugs, though it is not an antiplatelet drug. Then, fibrinolytic defects may also fall under the category of differential diagnosis of the VW disease. Then, platelet type of the von Willebrand disease is also a differential of the VWD and acquired von Willebrand disease. I mean, which is not an inherited genetic disorder. It is acquired later in the life. These are all important differential diagnosis of the VWD. Now the treatment. The DDVAP, which is D-amino-arginine vasopressin, which is an analog of the ADH or anti-diuretic hormone. It also enhances the anti-diuretic activity. It does not possess any pressor activity, but its job is to increase the release of the VWD factor or von Willebrand factor, which is an antigen, and it is stored in the platelets as well as the endothelial wall. So the job or function of the DDVAP is to release the VWD factor from these releasing sites, and which help in the stoppage of the bleeding. Then recombinant von Willebrand factor, von Wendy, is also a drug of choice in the treatment of the von Willebrand disease. Similarly, von Willebrand factor plus factor 8 concentrate, if combined together and given, they are more effective with the compared to the single administration of the von Willebrand factor, because the job of the von Willebrand factor, earlier told to you, is to save and protect the factor 8 so that the deficiency of the factor does not occur, and deficiency of the factor 8 does produce hemophilia or bleeding problem or bleeding diathesis. Similarly, the anti-hemophilic factors plus von Willebrand factor combinations are available in the name of alpha-8, humate-P and violate. It are used commonly in the West as well as in our countries for the treatment of the von Willebrand disease. Then estrogens, which are pro-coagulants like ethinyl estradiol, can also be used. They help indirectly. Then antifibrinolytic drugs. So you know, fibrin, conversion of fibrinogen to fibrin is the ultimate clot formation phenomena. So if you offer antifibrinolytic drugs, the bleeding stops. Among them are aminocaproic acid and tranexamic acid. which may be given orally as well as intravenously. Topical agents include the fibrin sealants. They may be offered in the dental surgery, surgical procedures, and when there are skin wounds which are bleeding. So for healing of the wound, you can offer or apply fibrin sealants which stop the bleeding. And especially in those cases which are unresponsive to the drugs, and you can also offer the concentrates of the fibrin. In the refractory cases of the von Willebrand disease, platelet transfusions is also an option. And similarly, the cryoprecipitate and FFP, which is the contains the huge amount of functional factor 5, these can also be given to the patients of the VWD. But there is a risk of viral infection with the cryoprecipitates and FFPs. Keep in mind, the prophylaxis in minor surgery, the von Willebrand factor plus factor 8 are co-administered before the major surgical procedures. Whenever it is indicated in emergency, you can prophylactically offer the combination of these two factors, VWF and factor 8, and you can perform the surgery. The jobs become easier. But there is a risk of thromboembolic complications. Von Willebrand disease in pregnancy. VWF factors level increase in patient with non-type 3 von Willebrand disease. So with functionally normal VWF factor, labor and delivery proceeds normally. So remember that in the VWF levels increase in patient with non-type 3. So meaning thereby, in type 3, there may be a problem. In type 2 von Willebrand disease, the type 2 von Willebrand factor, there may be hemorrhagic problems in pregnancy. And similarly, von Willebrand type 2B have thrombocytopenia. So monitor bleeding in delivery and postpartum, because platelets are also an important part of the coagulation pathway or clotting pathway. Deterrence, prevention, avoid aspirin to the patients of the von Willebrand disease. And similarly, severe physical activity like gymnasium, gymnastics, etc., because it may produce bleeding. See, the conjunctival hemorrhages, which are spontaneous one in von Willebrand disease, these are the signs of the VWD. Then subperiosteal hemorrhage presenting as a cephalohematoma, earlier told in the description of the signs. So here is a swelling over the right side of the posterior occipital area, and actually it is a subperiosteal hemorrhage. Spider angioma is also a feature of the VWD, and similarly telangiectasia, earlier described, they may also be found in VWD. Now arthropathy, the joint synovium and cartilage is damaged, and see the joint is somewhat deformed and lax, etc. And similarly, the patients may present with the dental bleeding, epistaxis earlier told, and menorrhagia already discussed with you. And these are the bleedings which are spontaneous and huge bleedings or excessive bleedings, sometimes worrisome to the patient, and they require treatment multiple times. Every time there is huge hemorrhage or profuse hemorrhage, the patient has to go to the doctor for the treatment. Again, the repetition of the dental bleeding, and this is the post-trivial injury bleeding from the dorsal surface of the arm. Similarly, see there is spontaneous bleeding from the mucous membrane of the lower lip in case of von Willebrand disease. Trivial injury producing bleeding from the finger, which is not stopping, and the patient has to get treatment, especially the fibrin sealants. Next is hemophilia A. It is an X-linked recessive disorder caused by the deficiency of the factor 8, which is inherited, and there are spontaneous mutations as well in the implication of the hemophilia A. Then inhibitory allo antibodies to the factor 8 are also complicating the treatment of the genetic cases of the hemophilia A. Then autoantibodies to the factor 8, they are acquired later in the life in the hemophilia. Signs and symptoms, they are dependent upon the level of the factor 8 activity. The patient may have bruising, inadequate clotting, spontaneous hemorrhages, general weakness, orthostasis, which means the patient may have a fall in the blood pressure when he adopts the standing posture from the sitting one. The patient may have tachycardia, patient may have tachypnea. Then leading into the joints, and there may be tingling and crackling over the joints may be warm, they may be painful, they may be stiff, and the patient will be refusing to use the joints because of these limitations described earlier, and especially found in the children. In the CNS, headache, stiffness of the neck, vomiting, lethargy, irritability, and spinal cord syndromes are a common finding, but less common finding in cases of the hemophilia A. GIT hemorrhages like velina and hematemesis are also, and fresh blood bleeding from the rectum, they are also very common, but they are less common or not, they are not found or not a feature of the von Willebrand disease, especially they are common in the hemophilia A. Signs and symptoms continuing, then genitourinary bleeding like hematuria, renal colic preceding and will followed by hematuria, and there may be post-circumcisional bleeding. Then the miscellaneous signs and symptoms. Again, the patient may present with epistaxis as in von Willebrand disease, oral mucosal bleeding, spontaneous, then hemoptysis from the lungs and dyspnea, then compartment syndrome, and because of the accumulation of the blood, the patient may have pain, the patient may have change of the color, the patient may have pulselessness in the as part of the compartment syndrome, and decompression is the only solution. Then the patient may have contusions, patient may have excessive bleeding followed by the dental proceeding as in case of von Willebrand disease. Diagnosis, check the CBC, usually hemoglobin will be normal, platelet count will be normal, and normal PT, but APTT is significantly prolonged, the same way in von Willebrand disease it was. Then factor 8 assay, this is a crucial test, because basically in hemophilia there is deficiency of the factor 8, so there the assay done, the amount or level is checked. Then factor 8 inhibitory assay. There are some inhibitory factors to the factor 8, those whose assay has to be done for the treatment purpose, keeping in mind that the inhibitors are also circulating in the blood, so you have to combat them. BT is usually normal, and similarly the levels of the factor 8, they range from normally from 50 to 150%. In milder diseases, greater than by 5% of the levels are available or found. And in moderate disease, the level range from 1 to 5%. So I mean, as low as 1 to 5% is acceptable, but bleeding will not be accruing or occurring. And lastly, if the disease is severe one, the level of the factor 8 will be very low, it will be less than 1%. diagnosis, you may require imaging like MRI brain, NMRI spinal cord and column, and you have to check the spontaneous or traumatic hemorrhages in the brain as well as in the paraspinal areas. Then MRI of the joints are usually required for checking the cartilage, the synovium and the joint space. This is one of the best available tests for seeing the synovium, the cartilage and the joint spaces. Then ultrasonography of the joints can also be performed to see the effusion, especially the hemorrhagic one. Then testing of the inhibitors, I mean the inhibitors of the factor 8, especially in those cases when bleeding is not controlled with the factor concentrates, so you have to go for the inhibitors of the factor 8. Management, first of all the management hemostasis, which attempt to stop the bleeding, then management of the bleeding episodes and use of the factor replacement products and plus the adjuvant medications. Treatment of patient with factor inhibitors, I mean those cases where there are inhibitors against the factor 8. Then the treatment and rehabilitation of the patient with hemophilia synovitis, I mean the treatment of the implicated joint synovium. Disposition of the treatment, how you do it. You may refer the patient to the hemophilia care center, and sometime the home management may be done with the help of the infusions by the family. They are made to learn, they are taught, they are educated, they are trained, and the patient can do it at home because it is a lifelong disease and some patients cannot afford to go to the hospital again and again. Therefore, this technique has been evolved that the patient's family is educated and hemophilia is managed at home if the patient is customary, habitual. And factor 8 be given prophylactically or on demand of the patient. In case of hospitalization, it is done when there is severe or life-threatening bleeding or home infusion is impractical. I mean when the patient's family fails to manage the patients of the hemophilia at home because of the severe bleeding or life-threatening bleeding, the patient is transferred or shifted to the hospital known as hospitalization. The management of the acute bleeding. In mild hemorrhages like early hemarthrosis and epistaxis and gingival bleeding, the factor 8 level has to be maintained above 30%. Otherwise, minor disease will not be controlled. Similarly, in major hemorrhages, the level of the factor 8 should be maintained above 50%. Then it will be managed. And in case of life or limb threatening bleeding or major trauma, after major trauma or surgery or recurrent hemarthrosis and major GI bleedings or major traumas, then the factor has to be kept above 80%, 80 to 100%. So remember, in major surgical procedure or major bleeding phenomena, you will be requiring to stop the bleeding by keeping the factor 8 level between the range of 80 to 100%, otherwise you will not be successful enough to stop the bleeding. The calculation of the dose is done by dose in factor 8 in international units is equal to weight into kg multiplied by desired factor 8 and increase and multiplied by 0.5 international unit per kg, international unit per deciliter. And factor 8 regimes are given as follows. The second dose is given 8 to 12 hours after the initial dose as calculated above, and it is half the initial calculated dose. Say first dose is given 10 international units, the second dose will be half, I mean the 5 international units, and it will be given 8 to 12 after post first dose. In minor hemorrhages, there will be 1 or 3 doses will be required of the factor 8. But in the major hemorrhages, many doses of the factor 8 will be required, and the trough activity level must be maintained above 80%. Otherwise, major bleeding will not stop. And if the bleeding is very major, as earlier discussed, the level will have to be kept at 80 to 100%. If you offer continuous infusion of the factor 8, major hemorrhages can be manageable following the major surgery to keep the level between 80 to 100%. Continuing the management, then there are different types of the factor 8 concentrates, which are plasma based products, and they are purified to inactivate the viruses. And there are the first generation recombinant products, which contain human or human plasma derived proteins. And then the second generation recombinant products, no protein available in them, but in the final product which is prepared in the second generation products. The third generation recombinant products, they are similar to the second one. I mean, there are no proteins in the final products. Then extended half-life recombinant factor 8 products are also given. And finally, the DDAVP, D-amine D-arginine vasopressin drug attributes are given to the patients of hemophilia. It is not very effective in severe hemophilia, but in mild to moderate hemophilia cases, it can be offered in the dose of 3.3 microgram per kg of the body weight, and the peak effect emerges in 30 to 60 minutes, but it has a side effect, DDAVP, which is hyponatremia. So you keep in mind that whenever you offer DDAVP, hyponatremia may be a big challenge to you, because the patient may present to you with the fits, confusional state, etc. Then the concentrated DDAVP intranasal spray, a commonly used spray available in the market, and it can be used on the OPD basis. Continuing the management, then the antifibrinolytic agents like epsilon aminocaproic acid, they help the fibrin, and tranexamic acid may be given orally as well as IV. Then treatment of inhibitors of factor 8. High doses of factor 8 are given to the patients for low titer inhibitors. I mean, you kill the weaker enemy with the strong arm. So offer the high doses of factor 8 to combat the weaker inhibitors. Similarly, you can offer the activated prothrombin complex concentrates of the same factor. Then activated recombinant factor 8 can also activated. It helps earlier in the stopping the bleeding. Then monoclonal antibodies, they restore the factor 8 functions. See, the monoclonal antibodies are a sort of wide-ranging drugs which are used in many diseases, like we use in rheumatoid arthritis, in ITP, now in the hemophilia, and in the hemophilia used MCA or monoclonal antibodies is emisuzumab. Remember it is peculiar to the hemophilia A. Continuing the treatment inhibitors, porcine factor 8 having low cross reactivity with the human factor 8 antibodies. So there is no interaction, and factor 8 works and it stops bleeding. Then desensitization, so that antigen-antibody immune reaction does not occur, and the large doses of factor 8 are given along with steroids and immunoglobulin and cyclophosphamide, so that the factor 8 does function. So desensitization helps indirectly. Then immune tolerance inductions, known as ITIs. It is done by the use of the regular exposure to factor 8 for months to years, and rituximab, which is a chimeric monoclonal antibody, and it is used with success in ITI or immune tolerance inductions. Continuing the management, the minor symptoms, the pain management, NSAIDs are never offered. You can only offer the paracetamol along with the codeine phosphate, which is a preferable drug, because the aspirin 5-SA inhibitors, they have an interaction with the platelet, therefore they are never used in von Willebrand disease as well as in the hemophilias. Deterrence or prevention: do not circumcise the boys till the factor 8 assay has been done. Keep in mind. Then immunization is done by deep subcutaneous route, not by the intramuscular route, because of the risk of the hematoma formations. In severe hemophilia, consider prophylactic and schedule factor 8 2 to 3 times a week. Then carrier testing, prenatal diagnosis may prevent birth with major hemophilia. Sometimes the mothers are, usually the mothers are carriers. If you check it prenatally, you may prevent the disease, because it is transmissible to the male child of the female carrier. Continuing the management, avoid impact contact with sports and activities with risk of trauma. I mean, the severe activities, physical activities, are they should not be the advice to the patient. Rather, they should be contraindicated to the patient. Caution should be held to the patient. Similarly, the gene therapy is the final option, and ex vivo gene therapy, in vivo gene therapy, and the non-autologous gene therapy. These three types of the gene therapies are sort of chimeric therapeutic options. The complications: HIV associated ITTP, ITP, which may produce lethal intracranial bleeding, which is a complication of the hemophilia. Maintain the platelet count around 50,000 per ml in these cases, complicated cases of hemophilia. And you can offer the steroids, IV immunoglobulins, anti-D, which are and anti-HIV medications, and you can also undertake the splenectomy in such cases of ITP in the setting of the hemophilias. Differential diagnosis: acquired hemophilia, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, they have some similarities, therefore they fall under the purview of the differential diagnosis of the hemophilia. Then factor 11 deficiency, again presenting with the bleeding, and Glanzmann thrombocytopenia, again a functional platelet defect, the presentation will be similar in all of these, the bleedings one way or the other. Then hemophilia C, again the presentation will be the bleeding, and hemophilia B, again a bleeding disorder. Then physical child abuse can also produce bleeding, but it is a excessive physical abuse which produces the bleeding. Actually, there is no derangement of the factors of the clotting. Then platelet disorder of different kinds, like ITP, they also have to be kept in mind in the differential list of the hemophilias. And von Willebrand disease, of course, they are both the differential diagnosis of each other. See, bruising and bleeding into the subcutaneous tissues is a hallmark feature of the hemophilia A. Spontaneous bleeding, dental bleeding, I mean no surgery, but it can also happen with the post-dental surgical procedures. Bleeding from the palm of the hand after the trivial trauma in case of hemophilia A. Now hemophilia B or Christmas disease. It is an X-linked recessive disorder that results in deficiency of the factor 9. It may be because of the spontaneous mutation, and it may be an acquired disorder which is immunological process resulting in the deficiency of the factor 9. Hemophilia B constitute 20% of the hemophilia cases, a sizable number of the hemophilia cases. Role of coagulation system, fibrin clot at the injury site. You see, there are two pathways, intrinsic and intrinsic. In the intrinsic pathway, finally the factor 8 is the end product, and from the extrinsic pathway, the end product is factor 7. Now factor 7 and 8 both act on the factor 10, and then factor 5 and 10A, they combine together and they convert the prothrombin into thrombin, and thrombin convert the fibrinogen to fibrin, and then fibrin is finally transformed into the clot formation by the action of the fibrin sealants or factor 30. So remember these simpler words. From onward, factor 10 and 5, they act on the, they produce thrombin, and thrombin produces fibrin, and fibrin produces or is transformed into the clot. So this is the pathway of the both intrinsic and extrinsic. So you have to see the role of the fibrin and the prothrombin and the all the factor 8, 9, 10, 11, they are, and 7 similarly, and factor 5 and 10, they are all involved in the pathogenesis of the von Willebrand disease and the hemophilia A and B. Okay? Now sign and symptoms of the hemophilia B. Bleeding into the joints is a major symptom. The joints may be painful, and there may be long-term inflammation of the joints, and there will be deterioration in the function of the joints. Sometimes the permanent deformities are produced because of the excessive bleeding into the joints and destruction of the synovium and the cartilage of the joints. And sometimes the misalignment or deformities may develop because of the loss of the mobility and extremities. The deformities are so much that the extremities become unequal when compared to each other. In mild hemophilia, there will be bleeding with trauma or following the surgical interventions. Then moderate to severe bleeding or severe hemophilia, it may occur in the neonates, there will be prolonged bleeding, there may be hematoma after procedure like circumcision, after phlebotomy and after immunization, and the patient may land to you with the ICH or intracerebral hemorrhage or intracranial hemorrhage. Now you see, the joints and the brain are the major targets in this disorder hemophilia B. Toddlers, I mean those children who crawl, their minor trauma, there will be soft tissue hemorrhages, and patient may have oral bleeding during the teething process. In the children, there may be hemarthrosis, which means the bleeding into the joints, and hematomas with an increased physical activity. I mean the child runs and he develops the bleeding into the muscles or subcutaneous tissues, leading on to the hematoma formation. The child plays sports, and he will be developing the subcutaneous tissues or the hematoma. And similarly, the patient can develop chronic arthropathy and sometimes the traumatic intracranial or intracerebral hemorrhage. The signs and symptoms of the infectious diseases, they are related to HIV or AIDS or hepatitis in the hemophilia B. The patient may also have systemic features like tachycardia, tachypnea and orthostasis, earlier told to you. In the musculoskeletal system, joint may be tender on examination and they may be painful when the patient or child walks, and there will be limitation of movement or range of the movement of the joint will be lesser. Then there may be swelling or effusion of the joint and there may be balm on palpation. In the neurological finding, the patient may present to you with the altered sensorium and meningismus. In the GIT, there may be painless bleeding, or the patient may have hepatic or splenic tenderness and peritoneal signs. In the genitourinary, there may be bladder spasm. The patient may present to you with the distension of at the pubic area and the costovertebral angle. And others, miscellaneous findings, hematoma leading to the locations, specifically the airway specific location like airway obstruction because of the hematoma into the major airways. And similarly, the patient can have compartment syndrome when there is bleeding into the subcutaneous tissues or into the muscles. Then the investigation, the CBC will be normal count, hemoglobin levels, normal platelet count, actually the coagulation studies will be found to be abnormal. Factor 9 assay is the classical test. In mild disease, it will be about 5% available compared to the normal levels. In the moderate disease, 1 to 5% will be the availability, and in the severe disease, less than 5% it will be found in the circulation. So assay, it is a measurement, so levels will be ranging from 1 to 5%, less than 5%, I told you, with this, the patient will be a severe case of the hemophilia B. Then von Willebrand factor 8 levels, these are done to exclude the von Willebrand deficiency as primary diagnosis. And then the screening for the HIV and hepatitis are also done, because in both of them they complicate these bleeding disorders. Similarly, the genetic carriers should be tested by fetal testing. Then continuing the investigation, CT of the brain may be required to rule out the intracranial, intracerebral hemorrhages. Then MRIs of the brain and spinal cord are done to rule out the intracranial hemorrhages and paraspinal hemorrhages or PSH. And finally, to check the cartilage, synovia and joint spaces, the MRIs of the spines, etc. Similarly, the ultrasonographies of the joint is to see the effusions, and X-rays for the DJD or degenerative joint diseases. Treatment options are control of the hemostasis and treatment of the bleeding episode by offering the administration of the deficient factor, I mean the factor 9, and its products and other medications. The use of the inhibiting factors also. And further, you manage it by rehabilitation of the patient with hemophilia synovitis, because the patient develops the disabilities and deformities of the joints, that is, they require rehabilitation at the rehabilitation centers. And then the primary and secondary prophylaxis should also be offered to the patient prior to the development of the disease. Pharmacotherapy, factor 9 containing products, factor 9 recombinant and factor 9 complexes are given to the patient. Recombinant coagulation factor 7A is also helpful in the hemophilia B, which is actually affected 9 deficiency state. Then recombinant coagulation factor 9 is of tremendous value and help in the cases of hemophilia B. Then finally, the antifibrinolytic agents which are offered in all the three diseases, VW, B and hemophilia A and hemophilia B, and I have already told to you the aminocuprid acid and tranexamic acid. Then anti-hemophilic agent like desmopressin, anti-inhibiting coagulation complexes, anti-human hemophilic factors, recombinant anti-hemophilic factors, plasma-derived prothrombin complexes concentrates, and plasma-derived coagulation factor 9 concentrates. I am in a hurry because of the lengthy lecture covering all the three topics. So, remember the term anti-hemophilic agents. The list has been given, including the desmopressin and the plasma-derived coagulation factor 9 concentrates. The monoclonal antibody, you see, now these are the modern drugs. In this case, rituximab is of tremendous help in cases of hemophilia B. Analgesia already told, NSAID be avoided, paracetamol with codeine phosphate is helpful for relief of the pain. Deterrence or prevention, same as in the hemophilia A. Then activity limitation, same as in hemophilia A. Advise the patient to do not indulge in the strenuous sports activities to avoid the bleeding. Then the gene therapy, similar to the hemophilia A, the complications are similar to the hemophilia A. Now you see, in hemophilia B, mainly the joints are the targets, and mainly the brain are the targets, and cranium are the target. Now you see here the large effusion and deformity of the joint of the left knee. As earlier discussed, that in this case soft tissues and the muscles are the prime targets after the joints. See, the neck muscles and soft tissues, deltoid muscle and gluteal muscles, then the thigh muscle and the calf muscle and the iliopsoas muscles are the areas where the subcutaneous bleeding or intramuscular bleeding can happen, because these are the prime targets of the hemophilia B following the joints. Then the acquired hemophilia, as the name is indicative, it is a life-threatening disorder caused by the development of the autoantibodies or inhibitors against the coagulation factor 8. It is acquired later on in life. It is not a genetic disorder. Later in the adulthood, the patient developed the deficiency of the factor 8 by the production of the autoantibodies. That is why it is known as acquired hemophilia. The signs and symptoms: there will be bleeding into the skin and muscles and soft tissues and mucous membranes, and there may be, in the lesser number of cases, the intra-articular bleeding. You diagnose the patient by undertaking the conventional tests like BT, PT and platelet count, which will be found to be normal, but APTTB will be prolonged irreversibly, because factor 8 has a classical role in the APTT. So the APTT will be prolonged in all the three diseases, VWT, hemophilia A, hemophilia B, and the fourth one, acquired hemophilia B. So whenever you find a prolonged APTT with normal PT, do think of all of these diseases which I have discussed to you, right? So then when you check the factor A, it will be low, its level will be low, and there will be the presence of the factor 8 inhibitor by the reason the antibodies produced which are serving as the inhibitors of the factor 8. You quantify the inhibiting factors to exclude, you also exclude the lupus anticoagulants if APTT is prolonged, and the value during mixing studies are similar at time 0 and after the incubation. So you have to exclude the lupus anticoagulant because it comes in the contention of the acquired hemophilia. Then screening for the heparin levels should also be done in the diagnosis of the acquired hemophilia. The treatment is treat the underlying disorder, discontinue any drug, and you also have to eliminate the inhibitor, the autoantibodies. What do you do? You offer the high doses of the factor 8, 200 by the dose of 200 international units per kg. Bolus is given 3 times a day. The other option is desmopressin, which is in low titer inhibitor cases. I mean, when the inhibitors are in low titer, you offer the desmopressin, it will work. And in the moderate to severe bleeding, you offer the recombinant factor 7, which will stop the bleeding in acquired hemophilia. In the severe or major bleeding, and high anti-inhibitor, I mean the inhibitors are in huge amounts or large amounts found in the circulation, which are actually the autoantibodies, you will have to offer recombinant factor 7A. It is a classical drug used in the severe type of the or severe variety of the acquired hemophilia, or known as APCC, activated plasma prothrombin complex concentrated. These are the drugs of choices in major bleeding presentations of the acquired hemophilia. Remember, recombinant factors 7A and APCC. Then immunosuppression, by they help the eradication of the inhibitors, and it is done by methyl prednisolone oral, as well as the oral cyclophosphamide. Similarly, the rituximab, which are the monoclonal antibodies, they also have a role in the refractory cases of the acquired hemophilia. They do it by immunosuppression. Then salvage therapy is offered to the patients who, when the all of above mentioned options they fail, or there is a treatment failure with the above mentioned drugs, then you offer the cyclosporine in patients with underlying, especially the underlying SLE cases. Now, how do they present? Earlier I described that bleeding into the skin is the hallmark feature of the acquired hemophilia. Now you see, in this case the patient is having the front of the torso subcutaneous bleeding, or bleeding into the skin rather, into the skin bleeding front of the torso. See, back of the torso and the gluteal region into the skin bleeding. Similarly, here the into the skin bleeding on the abdomen of the patient, giving a red bluish tinge. Whenever you find this sort of tinge, do think of the acquired hemophilia. Similarly, the back of the thighs, I mean the extremities are there, they are not spared in the acquired hemophilia, but into the skin bleeding rather than the subcutaneous bleeding is the presentation, and they are recognized by the color change. See here, the classically the color tinge is more bluish than the reddish in these cases of the acquired hemophilia. Conclusion. Remember the conclusion. The von Willebrand disease presents with spontaneous bleeding, with trivial or major injuries or surgical procedures. Hemophilia A presents with bleeding into the joints after injuries or surgical procedures, but the bleeding is deeper one compared to the von Willebrand disease. And the patient may have spinal cord syndrome, and the patient may have GI bleeding. Earlier I told hematemesis and melena, which is not a feature of the VWD or von Willebrand disease. Similarly, the compartment syndromes are not a feature of the VWD or von Willebrand disease. Lastly, the hemophilia B presents with bleeding into the major joints and deep into the soft tissue and muscles. Remember, the joints and the major joints and the skin and soft tissues, and similarly acquired hemophilia cases, patient presents with the bleeding into the skin and mucous membranes and joints, muscles and soft tissues. Remember, in the acquired hemophilia, the patient presents with the bleeding into the skin, mucous membrane, joints and muscles and the soft tissues. Thank you very much. Now see the metaphor in this case. This lady is suffering from menorrhagia, but she acted and did not tell anyone and behaved that it is not bothering me, but actually it was killing her inside. Similarly, now finally she has a bloody tears. Actually she is weeping, but the presentation is conjunctival hemorrhage, which may be spontaneous one in cases of the von Willebrand disease. Okay, I say goodbye to the from Akhtasai Trust Hospital. Please do not forget to send the feedback. I have speedily covered these three topics in this time, though there are time limitations. Otherwise, I love to teach with more and more explanations to make you better understand. Even then, I expect the feedback. Okay, goodbye from Akhtasai Trust Hospital.